Right, we're just a couple of minutes here past 10, so we'll go ahead and get started with this Monday, December 6th meeting of the Policy and Innovation Committee of State Cog. So will everybody please rise and join me in the Pledge of Allegiance. Thank you. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic which stands. One nation under God, indivisible, liberty, and justice for all. Okay. Thank you. Okay, we'll go ahead and get started. Robert, do we have any public communications this morning?
No public comments. Would you like me to start with roll call?
That would be great. Thank you.
All right, directors, when I call your name, please indicate your presence. Director Bernasconi?
Here.
Burris? Absent. Frericks?
Here.
Gog?
Yes.
Lozano? Absent. Middleton?
Here.
Stollard?
Here.
Thomas?
Here.
Vice Chair Kozlowski?
Here.
And Chair Saragosa?
Here.
All right, we have a quorum.
All right, thank you. Okay, I jumped ahead to public communications, so we're good there. Let's go ahead and move on to the consent calendar. And are there any questions from members on consent? Do we have any public comments on consent?
No public comments.
We'll move approval.
Move to approve the consent.
Okay, thank you, Vice Chair Kozlowski, Member Gog. Roll call, please.
All right, directors, when I call your name, please indicate your vote. Director Bernasconi?
Yes.
Burris? Absent. Frericks?
Yes.
Gog?
Yes.
Lozano? Absent. Middleton?
Yes.
Stollard?
Yes.
Thomas?
Yes.
Vice Chair Kozlowski?
Yes.
And Chair Saragosa?
Yes.
Motion carries.
All right, thank you. Okay, moving along, we're gonna move to item five, which are reports. And this is the committee reports on Chair Gore's challenge. And Lynette, you have this item for us this morning? Or is it gonna be Eric?
The item before you today, just going back to the November committee, when Chair Gore was wrapping up the presentation where we heard from the housing developers and a couple of our jurisdictional staff, she issued this challenge to ask all of you to go back, talk with your staff and fellow council and board members about what are the housing innovation strategies that you're using in your communities. So that you could share with your colleagues from across the region here. So we did this at the last two committees as well on Thursday. And so wanted to leave some time on the agenda today for you all to just talk about things in your communities that you're proud of that are either underway or have been adopted that might be worth sharing with others.
I've got one.
Yep, go ahead, Mike.
So here in Folsom, we're kind of at the outset of it, but we are working with Habitat for Humanity to donate some land to them so that they can build some subsidized market rate housing near where our city hall is and close to Sutter Middle School. So they're going to build 10 units on five lots. So there'll be a main house and a ADU of sorts on the back end of it. And so duplexes of a sort, and they're going to subsidize the mortgage on those units so that the purchasers of them get to have a monthly payment that is something that they can manage on their whatever their income limits are, and then over time they can build up equity based on what they have paid, and then the portion of the mortgage as it is on the remainder of the value of the house that Habitat will hold, that gets forgiven over time. So the longer you stay in there, the more of the full equity that the person gains. The only catch is that at the point where the person wants to move and sell their stake in the place, they have to sell it back to Habitat, and then Habitat will do the exact same thing with a new occupant. So it's a little bit different way to do sort of low income housing that allows people to build up equity in the same way that you would buying a house normally. So that's pretty cool. I don't know how scalable it is, because it's there were several things that had to kind of come together. Habitat has to be able to find a financier for that kind of project. And Folsom happened to have some surplus land that we were able to effectively just give them. That's probably, if we were to sell, it's probably worth at least $750,000. So it's a substantial subsidy from the city in that way.
Thanks, Mike. That's great. I mean, I think that's one of the things I've always, brought up, even when we, in the REI committee and others, is how do you build towards ownership and some sort of, equity so that you can build, that generational wealth as you go forward. But that scalability is tough, because you're talking about, if you're doing this over, whether it's 10 units, 10 units or what have you, you need to find that, that backer, if you will, to be able to do something like this. Any comments from other members?
I took all of the suggestions that came in that presentation and asked my city manager about them. And he said, we're actually doing all of them currently. But in his word, it's still not enough. We need the state to be stepping up with more public funds to help subsidize these projects. And I sometimes wonder, I'm not a finance guy. I sometimes wonder if, if you're in one of the, just say the hotter real estate markets in our region, you will find the lenders that are willing to work the deals to make these things happen. But I think probably in those of our jurisdictions that are not as hot, so we say, it's just not happening. We've been working for 4 years to try to get a 162 unit project going that had inclusionary subsidized housing. And we had smart developers working it, and they could not get the financing. So, the way we finance housing now, everybody who buys a brand new house in our Southeast area is paying $11,000 into a fund that we use to make things like Mercy Housing's project here in Woodland work. So it's really all about money, I think, at the end of the day. And if your city is wealthy and you perhaps have the capacity to enhance a subsidy, that's great. If you're not, and I'm sorry to say my city is not, it's really hard to provide the subsidy. So I don't want to keep passing the buck, that's a lot of that's going on, but I really do think it all gets down to money to make these projects happen.
Thank you, Tom. So Member Ferrix and then Member Thomas.
Thanks very much, Mr. Chair. Good to see everyone this morning. One particular item that we've been working on is sort of an updated downtown plan for the city of Davis, and I think that it's sort of two parts to it. One, it is we're utilizing form-based codes for the downtown and sort of the central part of the city, and with the hopes, if it is successful, that when we move to sort of our general plan update, that we might utilize form-based codes sort of throughout the entire city. But that is, I think, one of the real sort of attractions to using form-based code is really that it helps sort of foster predictable built results, and sort of as opposed to just having this sort of by using physical form rather than the separation of usage as the organizing principle for the code. So I think that it helps to sort of take the mystery out of what might actually be possible to be built on a site, and so folks who are in the development community, but also even in the just like citizens and neighbors, also it takes the mystery out of it as well. So they have a sense of, from the very get-go, what actually might be built there. the types of uses that might, and the types of forms that might be built there. That's one component. The other part is that as part of the downtown plan, we are doing a sort of CEQA doc that covers the entire geography of sort of CEQA approvals that cover the entire area of the downtown Davis. And so therefore, once that is certified, any project that comes forward would be covered under, would already be basically approved for CEQA. So there would be an ability to, again, help provide certainty to investors that are trying to, the key, of course, is we're trying to do densification and transit-oriented projects that are especially near the, adjacent to the train station in Davis, plus lots of bus routes there too, but just really trying to make sure that there's an ability to sort of help remove roadblocks and provide more certainty for those that might want to invest in housing, especially in the downtown of our community. Thanks.
Thank you, Lucas. And I love that idea of the CEQA covering the entire, that entire area, so that you're just ahead of that and you're not coming up with, you know, ones and twos as you go forward on each particular, you know, development. Okay, Director Thomas.
Good morning, everyone. Kind of piggybacking on what Lucas was talking about, we haven't quite gone as far as form-based codes, but we're also working on being proactive in terms of getting our community engagement ahead of time before any project comes forward. So we're working on community region design standards. We have design guidelines in some areas, but we're working on codifying them and getting the community together to, rather, they're really good at saying what they don't want project by project, but we're working on getting them to talk about what they do want and turning those into standards so that any project that comes forward, especially projects that are streamlined from the state, that we have those standards in place that can kind of help alleviate some of our community's concerns that a project isn't going to fit the character of our individual communities. So we're in the process of doing that for each of our community regions. And that'll probably take us a couple of years to really roll out, but I'm really excited about that project because design can be everything. The other thing that after our last SEGHOG, what's that workshop on housing, which was fantastic, I thought, went back to our staff and talked about the idea of moving to a square footage fee rather than a per unit fee. And I know I'm preaching to the choir here, but I didn't even think about that so many of our, you know, our fees, of course, are fees that we can't control, like school districts and all of the other, you know, fees to get to community service districts that we don't have control over. And so what we've done is we've moved and we restructured our traffic impact fee program to a square footage of development. So at least on that side, which we can you know, control to some degree, that can help the cost of development. And so anyway, great ideas, great conversation. I appreciated this challenge.
Wendy, can I ask a question? Is that,
sure, Michael.
That square footage fee, is it scale as you go up so that it's a limiting factor on square footage also?
That's
not just savings if you build something smaller.
That's a really good point, Mike. Let me get an answer to that. Get back to you.
I could imagine a scenario where you do a progressive square foot charge where it actually limits the size of things over time to kind of conserve space and deal with, you know, anti-growth type constituencies.
I didn't even think of it on the other end. Yeah, yeah. Thanks. I'll find that out and get back to you.
Sure thing.
Okay, Director, thank you, Wendy. Director Lozano.
Yeah, good morning, everyone. I just wanted to add in, here in Galt, we're pretty flexible in terms of development and we try to do a really good job of encouraging some small development, infill development, related to the process at our planning department and try to be real friendly in that fashion. Many of the other things that were mentioned already, we are either embarking on or already doing. I think one of the things that our staff came back with was, which I think many people probably have the same issue, is that in part of our older part, well, in our older part of the city, we have many, many lots that over time were never developed, or they were developed and they were old farmhouses that didn't have, they had septic and wells, right? And so getting utilities to them is a big hurdle for us and a big expense that developers are unwilling to take upon themselves. And so what we're finding is that, and there's a great little project on A Street that if we could get sewer and water there pretty easily, it would be a three duplex unit, really nice unit. But there's just no way to get, there is, it's just very expensive. And so that's one of the things that we're going to be working on here in the next year or so, is to look at how we can do that. And again, I think to go back to Director Stollard's point is that it would be nice if some of this money could flow down from the state, to assist with that, so that we could, do move some of these projects forward and really encourage developers to do it.
Thank you, Director Lozano. From Placerville, you know, one of the things, and this is really a hat tip to Director Thomas when she was on City Council in Placerville, was the creation of overlay zones that the city did in order to help eventually build in some affordable housing units in our area. I mean, we're sort of, there's not a lot of room in Placerville to build. And so this was one way for us to get, to be able to hit our affordable housing numbers and have that out there. And so those overlay zones, eventually the timing was right and we were able to get two developers that came forward. And so we have about 160 units that will be coming in with those two. And then with the State Armory, on the fairgrounds, that State Armory is also now going to be converted to affordable housing units. We have about 240 units over the next several years that will be coming forward in Placerville, which is huge. I mean, we haven't had anything like this in well over 30 years, maybe even longer than that, in Placerville. And so it will be a huge help to, especially with our service industry and for folks, even people making $50,000-$60,000 a year to be able to get into some of these housing units. I mean, my only thing that I would say, and I'll keep repeating this, is that, you know, while it's great to have these houses coming on board and we need them, there isn't an ownership track on these. And so it's still something I think that every jurisdiction struggles with, and we do across the state, of how do you build people to move into this type of housing, but then get them on an ownership track as they go forward to build that, as I say, generational wealth as we go forward. But we're really, really happy that we can start bringing some of these units into the city here as we move forward. And I don't know, Eric or James, I don't know if you have any other anything you like to add at this time?
I think as we were saying earlier, I really appreciate the discussion. We had very good discussion in the other two committees as well, and definitely understand the need for the state in many ways to help us out, but also the need for us, I think, as local jurisdictions to do and to keep pushing what we can push, right? And I will just go back to those. And it sounds like what I'm hearing this morning is that a lot of your jurisdictions are really working hard on things, which is really, it is great to hear. So number one, you know, if you hit roadblocks or you get people pushing back, let us know. That's, you know, partly why we are here, to help figure out how we can help you and your staff overcome those roadblocks or challenges or skepticism. And then, you know, secondly, I'll just go back to the parking minimums in particular, right? That's a hard one. We recognize that. I hear it myself in my own neighborhood. People right here in Midtown Sacramento, people worried about parking spilling on the streets. And that said, remember our discussion around AB 1401 and the bill that would have prevented you from setting parking minimums in sort of in transit corridors and more walkable areas. And the will of the board anyway, right, was to say, let's not have the state tell us to do this, let's do it by ourselves. So I still have that question among others that sits out there for all of you, because if I think Dov Caden and our staff had presented a graphic, we're very high still on our parking minimums. We're very high, and we look across our jurisdictions and averages up close to 2 or over 2 in some cases. And just back to the workshop, as Eric said, to start this off, what's one of the things that Doug Shoemaker from Mercy Housing said is, let me figure out what I can park. You know, I know my clients, I know my constituents. If it's senior housing, I know those folks, I know what they need. And if you give me flexibility, I can do more. I can build more housing for people if you give me requirements for less housing for cars, and I can figure out that. So just to round that out, but really appreciate the discussion. Obviously, it doesn't stop here, but I think it's an excellent one. Also, as we just head into Green Means Go and the $38 million that we've got from the state and trying to award those grants in the upcoming year.
Thank you. The only thing I would add to that is just, you're going to hear from Sabrina Bradbury in a couple minutes about our state advocacy platform. And, while there's a lot of excitement about the huge state surplus that's expected again, just like we did with Green Means Go, we need to be ready to say why the housing fund should be spent in our local communities versus all the other things that are pulling on the state. So we want to work with you as that discussion kicks off in 2022.
Thank you, Eric. Thank you, James. The one thing, and I don't know, James or Eric, if you know this or if we're doing this, but I'd love to have like a little summary of, some of all the different jurisdictions that have set up, just to go around to the entire board, just as I love to see those best practices and, things that we could share back with our staff in case there's something that they haven't seen or just, whatever it might be. I mean, I love what Mike's doing in Folsom. Just those small things that we could share around, with each other.
Sure. We'll pull the notes together from all the committees.
That'd be great. Thank you. Okay. Great discussion, everybody. Robert, any public comments on this item?
No public comment.
Okay, great. Thank you. Okay, so we will move on then to our action items and on to item number 6. And this is to review and accept fiscal year 2020-21, our annual comprehensive financial report and related audits. And Ms. Sue has this item for us this morning.
Good morning, Chair and member of the boards. Loretta Sue, Finance Director. SECOG, as a metropolitan planning organization and as an agency receiving federal and past due funds, is required to undergo an audit annually. Two independent financial audit firms, iBailey and Richardson & Company, completed the audits of SECOG Financials and Transit Fund and have prepared the annual comprehensive financial report and the transit funds audit report for the fiscal year ended June 30th, 2021. Staff is pleased to report that SECOG received a clean opinion audits for both of the audits. So I'm gonna quickly go over the attachment that is included with the staff report, and then gonna turn it over to Ms. Carly Ransom, senior managers from iBailey, to go over the audit process. So included in the attachment, attachment A is the SECOG annual comprehensive financial report. This report is broken into several sections. The first section is the introductory sections. This section includes a letter of transmittal, which is an executive summary introducing the financial statement along with other required information. The second section is the financial. This section includes the independent audit report from iBailey, the management discussion and analysis, which is the management overview of the financial positions and activities during the fiscal year. It also includes a description of how the budget is adopted and how it's being managed. And it also includes or identify any major issues, if any, and then the projections of futures financials. The third section is the statistical section. This section contains various unaudited demographic of Sacramento region and historical financial statement of SACOG. And lastly is the single audit section. This section is a requirement for agencies such as SACOG that receive federal grants or award in exceed of $750,000. And it includes audit report on their finding as it related to the federal programs. The single audit resulted in a no finding for current fiscal year. And then attachment B is the required communications to SACOG Board of Directors regarding SACOG financial audit, which address any audit findings, difficulty encounters in performing the audits, corrected and uncorrected misstatements, or any disagreement with management during the audit process. And then lastly, attachment C through E are reports from Richardson and Company. They conducted the audit of several transit funds that managed by SACOG, which includes the four counties LTF funds, and then also the STA and SGR funds. Now I'm going to be turning it over to Ms. Carly Ranson. She's going to go over in more detail about the audit process and then answer any questions that you might have related to the financial statement or the audit process. Carly?
Hi, good morning, everybody. I'm going to pull up a couple slides on my screen, although it says host disabled participant screen sharing. I'm not sure, Robert, if that's something.
Go ahead and try it again.
Okay. You should be able to do it now. Yeah.
Got it. Thank you. Okay, perfect. So good morning. As noted, my name is Carly Ransom. I'm an audit manager with Eide Bailey, and we are an independent accounting and auditing firm. We were engaged by SACOG to perform annual auditing services. And for the next couple of minutes, I'm going to be summarizing the results of our fiscal year 2021 audits performed. So under our engagement with SACOG, we're performing essentially two audits. So the first is an audit of SACOG's financial statements as of June 30th, 2021. And the objective of this audit is to verify and give an opinion or assurance on amounts that are and disclosures that are included in the financial statements. So we're reviewing the financial statements and performing tests just to make sure all the balances and disclosures that are included are accurate and complete. Connected with that audit, we also provide a report on internal control over financial reporting and on compliance in accordance with government auditing standards. So as part of our audit, we're also looking at internal controls at SACOG. So, you know, those would be those mechanisms in place to make sure that financial transactions are appropriately recorded, reconciled, and approved throughout the year. Our second audit that we perform is referred to as a single audit, which is an audit of federal funding that is received and used by SACOG during the year. So the single audit is more of a compliance audit where we're looking to see if SACOG was in compliance with federal regulations, using the funds appropriately and following the grant guidelines that are attached to the funding for the year. So this slide goes over a few of our responsibilities in accordance with professional standards. Our responsibility is to form and express an opinion on whether these financial statements are presented fairly in all material respects with accounting guidance. So our responsibility is to plan and perform our audit to obtain reasonable rather than absolute assurance. So as part of our audit, we're designing procedures and gathering evidence over those balances that are included in the financial statements. But we're not giving absolute assurance. We're not testing 100% of transactions, but rather a representative sample of transactions. We also consider internal control over financial reporting. As I noted earlier, you know, we do look at internal controls in place. We don't give an opinion on internal controls or assurance, but if we run into internal control issues, those will be reported within our audit report. So this slide just gives a brief summary of our audit results. So for the financial statements, we issued an unmodified opinion on the financial statements, which that basically means a clean audit report. So we did not run into any issues during the course of our audit for the fiscal year ending June 30th, 2021. We also did not note any material internal control weaknesses or instances of non-compliance reporting. And for the single audit, which is the audit of federal funding, we also had an unmodified opinion, which means that there was no compliance issues with SACOG's federal grants or the usage of those funds. So as Loretta noted, I think one of the attachments, there's a letter that we submit to the board that goes over a few auditor communications at the end of our audit, ethics and independence. So, you know, us as Ide Bailey, we've complied with all relevant requirements regarding independence. We're independent from SACOG, which is necessary to give an unbiased opinion. Significant accounting policies. There was no new significant accounting policies or standards adopted in the year that we were looking at. And significant estimates. We disclose in the letter if there's any balances in the financial statements that are based off of estimated amounts. So for SACOG, that would be the net pension liability and the net OPEB liability, which are essentially estimates of those liabilities. However, those are prepared by third-party actuaries on behalf of SACOG. Misstatements. So we don't have any auditor audit adjustments to the financial statements. So you know, all of the balances that were reported in the financial statements are materially fairly stated. And we also did not have any consultations with other accountants during the course of the audit. And then significant difficulties. Here we would note any significant difficulties dealing with management throughout the audit, which we've had none for this year, and also no disagreements with management that arose during the audit. So that was just a very brief summary. We gave clean audit opinions for the fiscal year ending June 30th, 2021. I can answer any questions at this point. Otherwise, I'd like to thank, you know, accounting and finance at SACOG, Loretta, for all your assistance throughout the audit this year.
Thank you, Carly. Any questions, members?
All right. If there isn't any question, I'll move to approve the financial.
Thomas, second with a hearty congratulations to our team.
Yes, absolutely. Thank you, Director Thomas and Director Dogg. Do we have any public comments?
No public comment.
Okay, then. Seeing none, we'll go to roll call.
All right, directors, when I call your name, please indicate your vote. Director Bernasconi?
Yes.
Burris, absent. Frerix?
Yes.
Gog?
Yes.
Lozano?
Aye.
Middleton?
Aye.
Stollard?
Aye.
Thomas?
Aye.
Vice Chair Kozlowski?
Yes.
And Chair Saragosa?
Yes.
Motion carries. And
thank you. And Loretta, thank you. And thank you to your team for always doing a great job. So appreciate it.
Thank you.
Okay, we're gonna move on to item 7, and that is to approve our 2022 legislative platform. And Sabrina has this presentation this morning. Thank you, Sabrina.
Thank you, Chair. Good morning, committee members. The item before you is to recommend that the board approve the 2022 advocacy principles. Additionally, I and our federal lobbyist, Devin Barnhart, will give an advocacy update as part of this item. On the advocacy principles, they are not drastically different from what we had in 2021. We added more explicit language related to racial equity, additional transportation funding language in light of potential reconciliation discussions, and language to support policies that accelerate infill housing production. These principles provide board direction to staff on the types of issues we should monitor and pursue. For state advocacy efforts, we are working with our lobbyist KP Public Affairs and Green Means Go stakeholders to refine our advocacy focus related to accelerating infill development in green zones. We are further exploring some of the policy ideas that came out of our roundtable discussions with Green Means Go stakeholders to determine where we might have opportunities to reduce barriers to infill development. And we really appreciate all the great work that you are all doing. It was amazing to hear all that you have going on at the local level and with Chair Gore's call to bring your ideas to committee discussions. There's much we can do at the local level to accelerate infill in green zones as we continue to advocate for changes at the state level, and definitely hear your call for more support there on the funding side of things. We'll come back to you with an update on our state legislative platform next year as we continue to explore these policy ideas and where we should focus our advocacy efforts. But we know there are a few areas that we will definitely be doing some advocacy around. And those are state budget requests, of course, for transportation and Green Means Go related investments. The Legislative Analyst's Office projects there'll be $30 billion surplus, as we mentioned, in the state budget. So we'll definitely be doing a lot of work there. Then on SB 375 related legislation, we'll continue to track any bills related to that and engage with legislators and stakeholders to ensure that any changes align with our local priorities in this area. And then finally, on commenting on funding guidelines, there were a number of new and existing programs that guidelines will be coming out for, and we want to ensure that our region can compete well in funding available for transportation and Green Means Go implementation. With that, I'll turn it over to our federal lobbyist, Devin, to give an update on federal advocacy, and then we can open it up to questions and discussion from there.
Hi all, I'm just sharing my screen. And put this in the presentation mode. Hello, well, as always, we're Devin and Jason, but it's just me today. I wanted to give a big status overview of where we are because there's been a lot of exciting developments, but there's still a lot going on in Washington. So it's helpful to sort of understand the flow of what's happening, to understand what may or may not happen next. One, infrastructure passed. This is a gigantic deal. It feels like it should be normal business, but the fact that such a big bill got done with such a high increase in funding is really something that's to be celebrated. We will continue to pat ourselves on the back all the way until, you know, 2 weeks from now when we have to start implementing that bill. So there's a couple of other big picture items that are happening. One, I'm going to spend a little more time talking about, that's the government funding. Just late last week, the Congress passed a bill that extends government funding, which is the appropriations bill, through February 18th. This is the bill that says how every single federal agency should be funded, including the Department of Transportation, and make sure they keep their lights on and that they're paying their bills. And so it's a very important bill, but in the context of transportation and the new infrastructure bill, it has a really important role, which I'm gonna spend a couple of slides talking about in just a second. The other big bill that we're watching is the reconciliation bill. I've given you all several presentations on this, but this is also now being called Build Back Better. So just keep it interesting. We just keep shifting names. So Build Back Better is the big $2 trillion pot that the president proposed. They call it infrastructure sometimes, but it's really, it's climate and schools. It's a whole host of really broad funding policies. That bill also has money that could really benefit many of the programs that we care about. There's high-speed rail money, there's a transit pot of funding, there's also several helpful housing pots with, you know, multiple billions of dollars in each of those programs. And so we're going to continue to watch that. The timing on that bill is much more up in the air for all the same reasons that it's been up in the air to date. In fact, we've actually added a couple of new ones. The old ones were that some senators were concerned about spending so much. The new ones are inflation. And every day that we get closer to the midterm elections, it becomes more and more a political issue, as if it wasn't already a gigantic political issue. So question marks on when this one gets done. The Democrats in the Senate have really been pushing to get it done before the end of the year. That has been the mantra for the last umpteen months. really looking like next year. So we'll continue to track that one. And then the big ticket item that everyone's talking about in DC that's eating up all the oxygen in the room is the need to increase the debt ceiling. The passage of the infrastructure bill actually made the debt ceiling, the flexibility that we had before we hit the debt ceiling, actually really shrunk that. And so there's a whole bunch of machinations happening now in Congress to try and get that bill passed. So there's still a lot going on. It's still a lot that we're watching, waiting to be passed. But I just want to flag one important issue, which is this appropriations. So normally the appropriations process runs somewhat smoothly. It's just how we spend our money. And appropriations laws, even though all of the highway and transit money that we get goes to the highway trust fund, means it's guaranteed, doesn't have to go through appropriations. Appropriations laws have one role in that part of the bill, and that's just to say, yes, you can spend that money that you put in your authorizing bill. So yes, you can spend the money that you passed in IIJA. I should have flagged this at the top, but IIJA is a mouthful. So everyone in Washington, DC has decided to just call it bill, which is bipartisan infrastructure law, or BIL. I've heard every variation, but that's what the new reauthorization bill will be called by all the folks. So you won't hear IIJA too much. It's a mouthful anyhow, so I'm happy to not use it. But the one piece that the appropriations bill has to do is say, like, yes, you can spend those big new pots of funding. And so this means that because they passed a really short-term appropriations bill that just goes to February, it means that we don't get all the way up to that top blue box of new funding. We only get down here where that red line is, around the $18 billion mark. This looks like a big problem. Looks like, oh, you can't spend all this new money we just passed, but it really ends up not being a gigantic issue yet. So the reason I'm flagging it now is that it could become an issue in February if we don't resolve it when they do the next appropriations bill. And I will just show you just a couple of reasons why it's okay. One other, I put the highway funding up here because it's easiest to see. It also impacts transit. So no one in the highway and transit space will be able to spend and won't be able to contract out their new plussed up money yet. But the good news is it actually doesn't have a big impact on process. So because that plussed up money can't go out the door yet, doesn't mean that states and MPOs they will know how much money they're getting. They can start planning to spend that money. They just can't let the contract yet. West Coast is a little different, but in much of the country, no one's really letting projects these next couple of months anyhow. We don't start to let projects till the spring in advance of the summer season. So it's not gonna hugely impact what we're doing, but if they don't resolve the issue in February, we'll be back here talking about it. The other reason this is not such a big deal is because everyone's starting to get really exercised about it and is complaining to Congress that they need to fix the issue. So we're pretty hopeful that that message is going to be conveyed clearly. The other reason that this isn't sort of devastating news is because they can still spend all the rest of the new money. So they're still able to put out the new plus up money. This is the $550 billion over 5 years, but they'll still be able to put out all of the discretionary grants that the department has available for next year. So it's a little bit of good and bad news, but on the whole, it's not a huge impact yet. We're going to keep watching it. It's something we'll be paying attention to. But the only thing that's important for you to know is we have this little fix. We need it to be made, and it's going to be something we're eyeing for February. So what happens now? Now is all eyes turn to the Department of Transportation in order to implement bill. They have an immense amount of new discretionary grants that we've talked about. They have the existing grants that still need to go out from past years. And so the department is really gearing up. They're hiring people. They're getting ready to put new guidance together on how these grant programs will work. They're doing a whole bunch of webinars. So you may be seeing a bunch of those coming your way, but really now is the time that they are prepping to get money out the door. The two big pots, again, will be formula funding that sort of flows naturally. It's based on metrics, goes to the states with pretty much minus this one appropriations fix, flows pretty smoothly to the states, and then to MPOs and others. And then this is where the department's going to be spending all of their time. These are the big discretionary grants where they get to pick the winners and losers. It is an immense amount of effort on their time to get all of these grants. It's immense amount of effort for all of the communities to submit all the grants. And so DOT is really looking for ways to streamline that process, to make it easier for folks, and to help ensure that that money gets out the door quickly. So that's what we're going to be working with folks at the federal level over the next couple of weeks, is just making sure that that we understand the process, we know how to apply for the grants quickly, we know which grants are coming and when. So that's all going to be happening over the course of the next couple of months as the department really gears up to get this bill out the door. And then just last thing, we've talked about this estimated timeline before, but I think it's always worth sharing, is that, as I said, the formula money is pretty easy to go out the door. So states, I think it's after the 15th, states will be notified of what their apportionment, what the dollar figure of what they're gonna get. We all know it's in the charts now, but they'll get that official apportionment for the year. That piece flows pretty quickly for the authority that they have. And then the existing grants is what they'll focus on next, because they already have a bunch of work done on those. So any of the types of grants that we've applied for in the past that we know and love, things like TIGER, also called BUILD, also called RAISE, or INFRA, CIG grants, any of those grants that have gone out the door before will likely be at the top of the list to go out again, because the department already has all the rules written for those grants. After that, they're gonna try and focus on some of the big priority grants. You can already see the department talking about these when they're traveling around the country. They're doing a big push for folks to get excited about applying for all these grants. And the ones they've been talking about are rail projects, transit projects, reconnecting communities. So taking down highways or other types of infrastructure that have separated communities. So we can expect to see that those are going to be on the priority list of grants they try to get out the door. And then there are dozens of new programs and new grants. So not all of them are going to be in that first pot that happens sort of early this year into next year. Early next year into the end of the year. So there's going to be another set of grants that are just going to take a while, that are smaller to get out the door. They might try to come up with a way to make that process easier for this whole host of new grants, but we haven't heard any of that happening yet. So that's the big picture takeaway on where things are. Happy to answer any questions. Otherwise, we'll just keep you updated on what's happening next.
Great. Thank you, Devin. Any questions? Directors. All right. I do have a question on the state side, Sabrina, on SB 375. You mentioned shaping that language as we go forward. Are we proactively going to be providing not best practice, but some language potentially as that SB 375 language gets redone in the legislature next year?
So there are two bills still from last year that are carrying over to this year. And so it's a bit of waiting to see what happens with those. We have been in discussions with those authors' offices and committee staff. They actually held a joint listening session with MPOs, about 3 months ago, to not so much talk about the specific language, but hear more broadly what's working and not working with SB 375. So it's not clear at this point what amendments might come with those bills and what they might want to do going forward. So it's more just tracking those and then continuing to keep in contact with those authors, committee staff, and then also watching for any new legislation that might come out.
Gotcha. And I don't know if you have it in front of you, Sabrina. You know, who are the authors on those bills?
Cortese and Allen.
Cortese and Allen. Okay. So one easier to work with than the other. Okay. Gotcha. The reason I bring that up is because, I mean, with Steinberg obviously being here and being the originator of SB 375. I really do think our region has a chance to lead on this bill, so that if we put our language forward, what we think works best, we certainly having Mayor Steinberg, I think, be there with us on that certainly, I think, provides some heft to our voice. And I just think it's a good spot for us to be in as a leader on this issue when a lot of times we're, you know, taking the backseat to the bigger MPOs out there and, you know, just Southern California and San Francisco as a whole. James, I don't know if you had any comments there.
No, I think you're right on about that. It has been, by the way, a topic for those of you, as Director Ferrix would know, in the Mega Region Working Group. So I know, with MTC in particular, in San Joaquin COG as well, there's a lot of interest in 375, both in terms of having any kind of revisit or rewrite work for us and us to be actively engaged in that, right? And also, and as this committee has heard over the course of this year, there's an interest too in being able to kind of sync up the timelines going forward for some of our long range plans, which really best comes through a revisit of SB 375 and not through standalone for reasons I can explain to you later, but I would prefer not to get into now.
Yep, understood. Okay.
Chair Saragossa, if I can, just also while Devin is here and while the committee's here, we had a really well attended webinar last week with our advocacy consultants on the new IIJA infrastructure bill. A lot of interest and interestingly, a lot of questions from a lot of your staff. What should we be doing now to prepare for the competitive grants? So just a very quick reminder for everybody on this committee and the full board. Competitive grants at the national level for transportation were not a thing before 2009. It was really the stimulus bill and the creation of the TIGER program that then became the BUILD program that is now the RAISE program. Then we got the infra sort of freight goods movement competitive grant program. And now it's like the floodgates are about to open, right? So I think that's a good thing, as Devin said and explained. But I also think that we've been a little a nice way to put it is organic in this region about just having grant applications go in. I will say all applications are above average as far as I'm concerned, but sometimes we don't hear about them as SACOG until like the day before we asked to get write a support letter. I don't think we can afford as a region to be laissez-faire or to be kind of, let's throw everything at the dartboard. I think we're gonna have to be really strategic about these, right? Because the odds are slim. The odds will get much greater if we are sort of have a comprehensive, approach, and that all of you, when you go back to DC or you talk to your members of Congress or you have meetings with USDOT, whatever it may be, right? If we can be organized, we will be far more successful. So I just wanna put the pin in that as we come back next year with a lot of these grant opportunities. It's really for us, it's ours for the taking in some way, but we're gonna have to, I think, be a bit more disciplined and organized than we've been.
And James, this is a really good point. The department wants to hit home runs every time with the grants that they give out the door. They don't wanna have grants that have a lot of opposition or that folks haven't completely thought through. And so the more that there is sort of a regional support and that you have a strong thought out plan going into the process, the more comfortable they are going to feel giving these grants out. And so it really does strengthen each and every singular application and sort of the applications that you all put in as a whole.
Thank you. Any other comments, questions? All right, seeing none. Devin, thank you as always for the great update and happy hunting for us as we go forward here. Okay, do we have any public comments, Robert?
No public comment.
Okay, well, again, Sabrina, thank you. Devin, thank you. And we will hear back more next year. But again, thank you for all your work as we move forward here.
Mr. Chair, do we need a motion on this item?
Or oh, we do. I forgot to file and report. You're right. Thank you, Mr. Ferrix.
Happy to move the 2022 advocacy principles and agenda.
Thank you. So we have a motion. Do we have a second?
Lozano seconds.
Thank you, Director Lozano. Okay, any discussion, further discussion? Seeing none, roll call, please.
All right, directors, when I call your name, please indicate your vote. Director Bernasconi?
Yes.
Burris? I'm sorry, Director Burris, can you repeat your vote? I believe Director Burris is having some technical difficulties. I could not hear that. I'll come back to her. Director Frerichs?
Yes.
Gog?
Yes.
Lozano?
Aye.
Middleton?
Aye.
Stollard? Director Stollard, if you could indicate your vote. Absent. Thomas?
Aye.
Vice Chair Kozlowski? Absent. And Chair Saragossa?
Aye.
Director Burris, are you able to respond?
Yes. Can you hear me now?
Yes.
Okay, perfect. Yes, my vote was a yes.
Thank you. I'll let the record show that Burris voted yes. Motion carries.
All right, great. Thank you, everybody. All right, we're going to now move on to our information item. And item 8 is a meeting report out on our REI committee. And James has this for us this morning.
Great. Thank you, Chair Saragossa. I'm going to give a quick report out from the Race, Equity, and Inclusion Working Group from Friday, November 19th. We, as I think you all know, four of the directors on this committee. And this is the reporting committee for the REI working group. But there's four of you on here who were present for that meeting. So please feel free to chime in. But just a quick recap of that meeting, and just a quick recap really of where we are sort of in the map, the you are here in the larger REI schedule. So the Race, Equity, Inclusion working group, as you I hope all remember, has 10 SACOG board members and 10 public members, so a 20-member working group, and those public members were invited and selected based on their expertise, their experience, their role in state policy, folks like Carolyn Coleman, who run the League of California Cities, and many others. This was the third meeting of the REI working group this year. And again, as a reminder, there are three things really that we are trying to work on with the REI working group to have all of you form, inform, and then forward to the full board. Number one is a statement of change and commitment to racial equity, which is what I'm going to talk about today, which was the main topic from November 19th. The second is a racial equity action plan, which will be the focus of the working group next year. And the third is, looking at our long-range plan, the Metropolitan Transportation Plan, SCS, and working to figure out how we can best integrate equity generally and racial equity in particular into the long-range plan. So this is the first of those three, the statement of change and commitment. I will say before I get to that, there were a couple of really interesting homework assignments that Chair Jennings gave to the group. Which I do, if you have a chance to either review the video or actually look at some of the materials that we sent out, I think we had an excellent discussion on this. And these are two very provocative questions that are that Chair Jennings raised that came off Charles Brown's presentation at the REI working group before he came to the full board. The first is any system that is not diverse inherently biased? And the second is, does my neighborhood determine my future? So again, not necessarily wanting to, you can do whatever you want with this item, of course, but I just wanted to raise those because we had an excellent discussion, the REI working group. And I think it was that kind of warm-up discussion that is really important around the issues of racial equity. And there's some really good, again, highly recommended from my perspective, YouTube video and a couple of websites that I think are really good and that I actually want to bring back to the full board, connecting racial equity with economic opportunity and economic mobility. So the big things I said was a statement of change and commitment. Our actually intention recommendation was for the working group to take that up and actually forward it to the Policy and Innovation Committee. We had intended that to come to you today. It didn't get here, not because there wasn't a lot of good, robust discussion. and I think general support of the intent of the statement, but because there was a lot of questions that that we are now as staff are going to work on and resolve. We're going to bring a revised version just so people understand process and timeline. Next REI working group is January 14th. We're going to bring a revision back to that REI working group on January 14th. And then if that gets forwarded, it would come to your February meeting of the Policy and Innovation Committee. So I just want to flag that to say that this statement is coming. You can certainly look at it and read it from the draft that was presented to the REI working group. There's three parts of the statement. There's an acknowledgement, which basically in our attempt, and staff, by the way, staff, your SACOG staff has put a lot of work into this statement. We have a working group of the staff that's done a tremendous amount of work and research. So acknowledgement basically of really we're looking in for the role that government has played in racial disparities, racial inequalities, and structural racism. We're trying to boil that down to a paragraph, which is really pretty hard to do. But that's the acknowledgement piece. We have a very short, simple statement of commitment to reduce disparities by race, ethnicity. And then we have some very specific action steps that are in the statement and then will flow into the larger racial equity action plan. So three pieces of the statement. It was a very good discussion, like I said, I think, and I'd be happy to get the other board members to weigh in on this. We had quite a bit of discussion and comments and requests to look at strengthening the connection between reducing racial disparities, focusing on racial equity, and increasing economic opportunity. And then there was quite a lot of discussion around the term BIPOC, Black, Indigenous, People of Color, and a desire to name additional groups, additional populations that have been harmed. So we're gonna take that very seriously and get back to the REI working group on January 14th with a description by race, ethnicity of a bit more specific, a bit more maybe tailored to our region and our history here. So among other comments, those comments, again, staff will be working on bringing back a draft statement, as I said, January 14th to the REI working group, which will then, if they decide to do that, get forwarded onto this Policy Innovation Committee February meeting. With that, I'd be happy to answer any questions or hear any other input from the four board members who are there.
Thank you, James. You did a fantastic job, I think, of summarizing, you know, what went on at the last meeting. But does any other director want to make any comments that are also part of the REI committee? All right, seeing none. I know I'll just say, especially I think with our non-elected official contingent, you know, there was some not worry, but you know, they really wanted to see what we had agreed to in principle back in writing before they moved it on to this committee, which I totally understand. And so that's why, you know, we wanted to get it here today, but really to make sure everybody was comfortable and that staff had a chance to go back and take some of those thoughts and comments and kind of tailor the messaging a little bit more. That's why it'll be out just a little bit longer than we had originally planned. But I think at the end of the day, it'll be a much better process and I think statement as we move forward. So again, James and team, thank you for all the work on this. Okay, any public comments on this item, Robert?
No public comment.
Okay, and I didn't hear any other board members, so we will go ahead and file that item and move to item number 9, which is our draft growth forecast for the 2024 MTP SCS. And Garrett has this report for us this morning. So thank you, Garrett.
Great. Thank you, Chair. So some really important information we wanted to bring in front of this committee this morning. Your colleagues on the Lunar Committee have been hearing about this and that they're referring committee, but we want to make sure that both other committees heard about it this month. And that is, one of the very important first steps in our road to the next long-range transportation plan, the MTP-SES, and that's the regional growth forecast. And what this project does is it gives us our best estimate of where we think the region will be many years into the future. So these projections actually go out to 2050. That not necessarily is the end of our next MTP-SES, but it gives us the flexibility to go out that far if we so desire, if this board so desires. And really, like I said, it's our best estimate of where the region will be in terms of population and jobs and housing. And we sort of need that. It's a requirement of the plan. And it also helps us in that when we test sort of the policies and we build our investments around that, we need to know how many people are going to be here and sort of the jobs and sort of in what industries. An important point is this work we've done to date is still very much just at the macro or the 6-county regional level. We'll be working very closely with your staffs in 2022 on how that total gets distributed amongst the region. But you know, this is a draft forecast, but the point we've been trying to emphasize is this is our stab at it based on the expert panel and all the data we've been seeing. And so that we're really hoping that in this month we'll be receiving any input that your staffs may have on it. So if you haven't already, please ping your own planning staff to make sure they've seen this information come from us and that it's an important, it ends up serving as a constraint on the plan. We've talked about how the MTP is a constrained plan financially and in other aspects, such as in climate, it's also constrained in its growth. And so the charge put on us from our state and federal partners in this project is the growth we can reasonably expect to experience in this region. And so that is in this regional growth projection. A lot of technical information, but you know, to follow maybe along in the staff line, maybe the newspaper headline article, and it's a bit of a nuanced sort of presentation. But the first part of it is, like in the past, we continue to see this region has a lot of assets and strengths. If we look at all the data we've been looking at, and it's a lot, we feel very comfortable with the projection that shows our region, the 6-county region, growing faster than the state and the nation. We've had that projection in the past. It's a very important point to emphasize. But you know, the part and parcel of that, the other side of that is this projection is a slower projection compared to the prior series, compared to our prior MTP, the currently adopted MTP. This one is a slower projection. A lot of technical documentation, the attachments, some of the key points to emphasize, birth rates continue to decline. That's nothing unique to our region. It's actually a national sort of trend. Birth rates in this nation have never been lower. It's actually even an international trend. So if you think about the way our population grows from births within the region, from people migrating into this region from other parts of the country, and from people migrating into this region from other parts of the country, those lower birth rates, especially as you get out to 2050, really, the way I term it is sort of a demographic headwind, and that we're coming up against that demographic headwind of lower birth rates. And then we talk about some stuff on the job side. And again, if you look at sort of the last 10 years, jobs are very, it's very important to take at least a multi-year look at this, and that it's very, they go up and down sort of based on things going on in the macro economy. But if you look at more, try to get a more stable look at jobs, the last 10 years have been some very positive things, but we've been about at the state and national average. So again, we're projecting above that. We think there's a lot of building blocks in place, such as our prosperity strategy with GSEC and Valley Vision and the chambers and others that have articulated or identified what we think are the clusters of growth moving forward. But if we were simply to extend the historical trends, it'd be a lower projection than we see today. And then the third part of that, we talked about population and jobs. The third part of it is housing. And we know that housing is a big deal across the state. We know the challenges, and you know, just building off this conversation to kick off for the chair's challenge, focused on how difficult it is to deliver housing in this region, the state. We know that the state, or this region, like the rest of the state, has underproduced housing relative to population. We know there's a lot of great, you know, pieces in place, such as the Green Means Go program, all the things we heard about today that you're all doing in your local communities at the regional level, the state level, to encourage housing. But we, at the same time, we know that our region's facing seriously challenges around the cost of housing. And in particular, as incomes have been maybe more in line with inflation and housing costs exceeding that greatly, that's almost a check on the projection. So again, a lot of technical stuff, but we ultimately do ask this board to take a policy action on the projections, and we would ask that to come in February. So here's our preliminary projections. As I said, it's gone out to all your planners and stakeholders. We really are emphasizing, we'd hope to get any feedback in this month, the month of December, as we work to do the final tightening up with the projections and come back. to all the committees on the board in February, that final projection, which then sort of becomes that building block. We need it wrapped up in that all of the subsequent steps in our plan update are based on the growth that we put forward in that projection. So a lot of technical things in the appendices, more than happy to go into that, but I think the key points are continue to see our region growing faster than the state and the nation, but a slower growth paradigm than the last series. So that concludes my presentation, and happy to answer any questions.
Great. Thank you, Garrett. The one thing that stuck out to me in the report was the, I'm trying to see what page this is on, but the change in our rent was higher than any other like sort of region, over a 35% increase in the cost of rent, in our region compared to, Austin or even Phoenix, which I know has grown quite a bit, that we're still above that region. So that really stuck out to me in your presentation, or at least in the graphics there. So just wanted to highlight that for the committee here.
And on the one hand, on our positive perspective, right, that can be a market signal for new developers to come into our region and to really start thinking about doing more types of housing product. But on the other side of it, we know just how renters are very susceptible to that increase, and we know that our communities of color are even more susceptible. That goes back to our progress report at the beginning of the year that showed a thing called housing cost burden, which is how much does your housing cost relative to your income, and that our communities of color are the most housing cost burdened in our region. And so rent is very much tied to that. So it's an indicator we're tracking very closely, and it to go up so quickly, right? You would really hope that incomes would have gone up in tandem with that. And unfortunately they have not.
Correct. No, thank you for highlighting that. And it goes again, and I know I'm a broken record, but in terms of path to home ownership, because when you look at the cost of a monthly rent or lease, and then you look at a mortgage payment, and in many cases that mortgage payment's less money than if you're renting, but it's getting that initial, whether down payment or the amount to get into a home ownership path. And so you're actually paying more as a renter than you would if you own something, but it's getting that next step. So, something for all of us to think about. So I'll go ahead and open it up, and if there's any questions or comments from directors. Okay, seeing none. Robert, do we have any public comments?
No public comment.
All right. Yes, Director Lozano.
Thank you very much. I will have to say that this was one of the few items that was sent out to staff that induced a telephone call of excitement. And so I have to ask the question, well, if it appears that we're going to be reducing our population and everything by a third, or that's the projection out to 2050, would it be safe to assume that our greenhouse gas emission reduction is going to reduce as well?
So I'll start. Our greenhouse gas reduction is, it's set by CARB by the state. I have not heard anything about it being tied to the growth projection. So one thing we are very interested in with this growth projection is something I should have mentioned in the presentation is, it's not just what happens at the tail end of our plan of 2045 or 2050, but in the interim years. In 2035, 2035 is a very important year for our sustainable community strategy and our greenhouse gas targets. And so there is a good question about with the growth in this series, right, and the ability to meet that target. That's very preliminary at this point, but is something we're watching very closely at staff. But the greenhouse gas projection is not something that is done at the staff level, it's done through the state.
Right, and I understand that. It's just that, that's been a sticking point for many jurisdictions, and certainly with the huge increase this last time, I would imagine that reduction in many of these areas that you talked about, that we may have the ability to reduce that from 19% over time to something more palatable.
Director Lozano, just a reminder, it's I definitely we appreciate the quote. We figured this would, if this didn't generate a lot of questions, we'd start to get worried overall in terms of the demographic forecast, right, and the headwinds that Garrett just walked you all through. And I want to come back to those actually, but just on the greenhouse gas, one thing to remember, as much uncertainty as there is around is the target 19%, is the state going to revisit that? That's a per capita target. So it is a per person target. So the actual amount of population won't change the per capita per se. I do think it presents some interesting challenges in terms of, you know, a lot of our plan assumes what we would kind of call the build out of complete communities, that we are not just building housing in the middle of nowhere without services to support that, right? And so I stay tuned. So, but on terms of greenhouse gas, it's per capita, so it's not the total.
Okay, well, thank you.
I will, while I, since I mentioned the overall forecast, I've been talking to GSEC about this, right? Because I think, and Garrett did a really nice job basically sort of saying like, you know, here's the newspaper headline, but it's sort of a nuanced headline. There's a headline, then a subheadline, right? So the headline is, we have now, as you know, through the census data, been one of the fastest growing regions in California. And we don't see that letting up. So, in as much as those of you that feel like population growth is a good thing, and we're in that camp, we've got high numbers, but those numbers are significantly going to slow. And it isn't just our region, as Garrett mentioned, right? It is across the state. It's demographic changes. It's deaths over births. It's immigration. So it should raise questions for us. Those things are both potentially true, right? One is that we could still be a faster growing region for quite some time. So we got to get ahead of that growth, and we have to go back to the blueprint and everything that Casey walked you through last week. But at the same time, this is a big change. It doesn't mean that our economy is shutting off and, you know, and there won't be people, you know, there won't be population growth, because there will be, right? It's just not nearly, as we look further out, not nearly what we perhaps thought it would be or what it is in the closer years.
Thank you, James. Any other questions or comments? Seeing none. All right, well, to be continued, Garrett, thank you again for the report. And we will go ahead and file that and move to item 10. Which are the tentative programs for the 2022-2023 SACOG funding round. And Chris has this presentation for us. Thank you, Chris.
Thank you, Chair, and good morning, members of the committee. Let me share my screen quickly here. Can everyone see the PowerPoint?
Yes.
Perfect. Thank you so much. Again, Chris Doherty with the Transportation Group here at SACOG. The item before you today is an update on the funding round and an overview of the programs that we are expecting to launch over the next calendar year. Over the last 15 years, SACOG's funding round has been an important source of funding for the region's transportation investments. These competitive projects fund road, transit, bicycle, and pedestrian projects throughout the Fort County region. As we move forward into the next funding cycle, we aim to build on the successes of the last funding round while bringing the program into alignment with new state and federal policies. Because of the robust engagement effort and the successes of the last funding round, staff is recommending to keep the same framework for this funding round moving forward. But to bring those programs into alignment with new state and federal policies, we would amend the guidelines as we bring them to you to align with items like the state's new Climate Action Plan for Transportation Infrastructure, or CAPTI program, or both the state and federal new equity policies, as well as SACOG's ongoing effort to address equity in our region. All of these programs are designed to advance regional goals and to implement the MTP-SCS. I'll go for the descriptions of some of the programs. First, start off with the Rotating Match Fund. This is a new program. It was conceived in the last in the last funding round, but was not fully implemented. The goal of this program is to use a strategic percentage of the funding estimate to support local match and leveraging requirements for the state and federal competitive grant programs. With the signing of the new federal transportation bill, the IIJA, apparently we're not supposed to call that anymore, but I'll move forward that as. And as we just heard, a large percentage of the infrastructure or the increase in transportation funding will be through competitive grant programs. This program will be a very important strategic resource for our local partners as these new programs are launched at the federal level. Oops. Sorry. The Innovative Mobility Program, this is one that we have ran for a few years. This program funds a broad range of activities to advance TDM, telework initiatives, and Civic Lab. This program has funded several innovative pilot programs and projects throughout the region. We are currently discussing how to use this program and leverage it to meet the needs of a post-pandemic recovery while still supporting these current initiatives. We'll be bringing this program back to you with a new framework and guidelines later on next year to launch this program. The Engage, Empower, and Implement program, this was formerly known as the Disadvantaged Communities Pipeline Projects Program, which is kind of difficult to say. This will be launched next year. This framework will establish a planning process and funding stream approach that will meet the needs of the region's BIPOC communities and low-income communities. And the framework creation for this program will begin next spring and will be led by our staff, Rosie Ramos. You'll be hearing from later on today. And I'll move to the core programs. As I noted earlier, we are recommending to use the existing framework to move that was adopted last round for this next four county funding cycle. That framework created two programs that nest under the regional program. That is the Maintenance and Modernization Program and the Transformative Program, as well as carrying forward the Community Design Program. Maintenance and Modernization is a program generally designed for cost-effective non-expansion projects that are less than $5 million in cost. It is commonly used for state of good repair projects and projects that are easier to implement. The Transformative program is for all system expansion projects and projects that are larger than $5 million and create significant regional benefits. The Community Design Program, a mainstay SACOG program, is moving forward, and this supports placemaking that improves the livability of our communities and implements the blueprint ideals and supports the MTP-SES. Recent additions to this program include alignment with the Green Means Go and supporting green zones throughout our region. So as we roll out these programs, we expect to roll them out in a staggered approach over the next calendar year. We're going to start by determining the funding estimate for the programs. That'll happen very early in 2022. We are expecting probably in February at this point. A more definitive timeline that, for these programs will be developed with that funding estimate and will be brought forward probably at the same time. That timeline will be taken into account the timeline of other competitive grant funding programs, as well as the considerable outreach we'll be doing to local staff. Each of these programs will require significant input from the SACOG board and significant engagement to your staff. This will be the first of many discussions we'll be having about funding over the next year. So this concludes my presentation, and I'm available for any questions that you might have.
Thank you, Chris. Directors, any questions or comments? We have a shy group this morning. Robert, do we have any public comment?
No public comment.
James or Eric, do you have anything you wanted to add to Chris's presentation here?
No, I don't. Nothing for me today.
All right. James, anything on your end?
No, just I wanted to give you all the early heads up, right, as we head into 2022. We've had a lot of questions with the new infrastructure bill. I'm not quite sure about the acronyms anymore. But a lot of questions, which are understandable, kind of, you know, when does the money start flowing? What does it mean for us? When's the funding round going to happen? And we're going to come back to you, as Chris just lined out or outlined there, with a lot more details. Part of what your staff here is very good at SACOG and throughout the region is we plan for and fund and allocate money that actually is in future years. So in some ways we have planned for an infrastructure bill. We haven't planned for quite this much, but we have planned for this, number one. Number two, a lot of that increment and increase comes in non-transportation things that are great, like broadband and EV charging and the power grid. And a lot of it comes in those competitive grant programs. So don't be surprised if the fund estimate doesn't look like it's triple, because it won't be. But we will explain that to you. And we really what we want to do is make sure, and again, I think what we learned through our last funding round and the changes we made is good communication, early, often, engage your staff. So this is really a heads up to the region that in 2022 will be underway in the next cycle for the four counties.
Great. Thank you, James. And Chris, again, thank you for the great presentation. We look forward to each of these items as they come forward with no more clarity and as we see what those numbers ultimately look like. Okay. Thanks again. And we will move on to our last information item. Which is the Youth Leadership Academy 2022 cohort. And Rosie has this presentation for us this morning. So thank you, Ms. Ramos.
Good morning, thank you, Rosie Ramos. I am the project manager for the Youth Leadership Academy. I'm excited to be here today, sharing with you the newest cohort and getting ready to kick off year four. As you can see in your attachment, we have accepted 41 students from across the region. I want to give a big shout out to El Dorado County that really showed out this year with a lot of applications, and we have a good chunk of students from El Dorado County. So thank you to everyone that helped do outreach in all the communities. We also have 6 returning peer coordinators that are listed in the attachment as well. We have one student from year one, Tate Chatfield, which has been part of the program and she's been to our board a couple of times. 2 students from year two, and we also have 3 students from last year that will help us continue to improve the program and evolve it with their recommendations so that we continue to create a program for youth that's created by youth as well. Our curriculum for the next year will follow a lot of the previous year's themes, including a focus on transportation and land use planning that SACOG does, environmental justice, economic development. And this year, we're going to try to really emphasize housing and the unhoused community and mental health, because those were the 2 biggest topics that students from across the board just said that was the most important thing that they wanted to deal with in their communities. Next year is going to be a great opportunity for YLA to focus around some of the projects that SACOG is doing with MTPSES, Engage and Power Implement, Trails. There's a lot of opportunities that we can overlap. So we're excited to see how we plug YLA into those projects. One update from the attachment that I want to share is that our start date will actually be January 22nd, not the 15th. And then we did have orientation last Thursday, and it was really good turnout. We had about 30 students join us, and they just shared how excited they were about the program. So we're just overall excited to be here again and hearing their enthusiasm. And finally, I do want to just encourage you to all participate in the program next year. That's something that students really look forward to and already asked about at orientation. So if you haven't already, please send me an email letting me know that you're interested in participating so that we can start plugging in your expertise or theme that you'd want to participate in into the workshop topics. So that's pretty much all I have for you today. Everything you need to know is pretty much in your attachment, but happy to take any comments or questions.
Great, thank you, Rosie. Any comments or questions from directors?
Just a comment that I just think this is such a wonderful thing that SACOG does to engage the next generation. We just had our Saturday at the board with our local youth commission, and seeing the excitement in just being able to participate in local government, it's, you know, we take it for granted. It's our work, it's our job, and we just show up and we do it. We don't realize how how exciting, how complex, and how just inspiring it is. And so, you know, just want to thank SACOG for engaging the next generation. And I look forward to participating. So I'll send you my email, Rosie.
Perfect. Thank you.
Yeah, likewise. And I want to give a special shout out to James, Rosie, and the rest of the crew for giving us in El Dorado County a little bit extra time as well. So I'm really happy. And Wendy, thank you for, you know, getting the word out so that we got a good contingent out of El Dorado County. It's going to be my personal mission to get somebody from Placerville. Although we do have an El Dorado High student, I think from Pollock, that's going to be part of it. But I want to get a Placerville student as well. So, but thank you. And any other, yes, and also please add my name as well.
Will do. Thank you.
Okay. Robert, any public comments on this item?
No public comment on this item.
Okay. Any other comments? Going once, going twice. All right. Okay. So that is our last item for today. Any other items that board members would like to bring forward? James, anything you'd like to bring from staff level?
No, just a reminder that, obviously we have our final board meeting of the year next Thursday. We will not have a full board workshop as we typically do, so I can't guarantee you the quick meeting, but it'll be a little bit different. And then no committees in January. We kick off again with the full board meeting the third Thursday in January.
All right. Cool. Thank you, James. Well, thank you everyone this morning, staff and members alike. We had a full plate here, but you're going to get back about 27 minutes of your time. So with that, I will adjourn and I will see everybody next week on our board meeting call. Thank you, everybody.
Thank you, Michael. Thank you, everybody.
Thank you. Bye. Bye.